Sarah. Woo, there you go. So that we can see your background and fabulousness. Yeah. And let's hear all about let's hear all about change, managing it and expediting it.
Okay, so feel free to ask questions, please. If you've got anything that you want to stop me on, just stop me on. And if questions coming in about this, do let me know. So change is part of all of our lives. It has to happen. It's inevitable. And for some people, they absolutely thrive on it and they love it. And for the majority of us, there are times when we get really stuck. From Melinda's session last week, when we were talking about some people are more difficult, seem to be opposed to change. What I want to do today is help you understand what happens in our brains when change occurs. Because when we understand that, we can recognize where we are in the change process, which is the same, irrespective of the change that you're going through, from changing from a manual toothbrush to an electric toothbrush to moving countries. The change is the same. How long it takes to get through it and the feelings we have may change, or how long we stay stuck in certain places may change. But the actual process is exactly the same. So I'm going to take you through the change house, explain what happens in each one, and get you to think about the sort of behaviours that you'd be looking for to recognise where you are in the change process. But as importantly, if you're working in teams, where are your teams in this change process? And how can you help them expedite their own change and your own by being more effective with them, depending on what they're struggling with, why and how. Why do we bother doing this? If we understand change better and we understand ourselves better, we can manage our emotions towards it better. We can help others more effectively. So emotional self-control, emotional self-awareness, it's all emotional intelligence based. And it helps expedite it, speed it up, and make it much less stressful. All right. So I'm going to take you through the house of change first, and then I'll answer some questions as they pop up. But behind me on my flip chart, you will see what is called the house of change. You can find this on the internet. This isn't something that I've created. The first thing to consider is when we are comfortable doing what we're doing, we're in something called the room of content, which is nice. You know, we think about when we're content, we know how to do our job. We understand who we're working with. We know where we go. We know what we do. But after a while, this can get a little bit staid, a little bit boring. If we stayed doing the same thing time and time again, it would get boring. So we know change is coming. Now, if we stay there too long in the room of content and we're never challenged and no one gives us any projects to work on and we're never stretched, we go out onto the sun lounger, so onto the sun deck, and we just start to chill out. And really then your performance starts to go. It's not that you're disengaged, but you're not highly motivated, not highly engaged. And people can start to switch off and their ability to perform starts to dip. They just do what they need to do. There's no excitement to it. So we need change. It's important. So say I tell you that something's coming in that's going to change that. I'm going to give you a new project, or maybe you're going to lose your job, or maybe you are going to have to move from working in the US to Europe, whatever it is. The first thing that will happen is your brain will go into a threat state and want to save you from certain death, and you will go into denial. So denial is the first room after content. Now in denial here, you are not wanting to believe that it needs to happen. You're afraid. You've gone into a fight or flight state. And this is because familiarity, the brain wants familiarity. It feels safe when it's in a familiar territory, even if it's uncomfortable and it doesn't like it. As long as it's from a familiar pattern, it's happier. When we say change is coming, our brain goes, oh, it's going to kill us. We need to conserve our energy to stay alive. Therefore, I will do anything to stop you. And the first thing I'll do to stop you is tell you, you don't need to do it. So even if you're being told you're about to lose your job, you go into a state of just disbelief. It's not going to happen. This can't happen. That's denial coming in. Now, if you think about, I'm going to ask you, Vanessa and Melinda, actually, what sort of behaviours do you think you could recognise when someone is in denial? What are they saying? What are they doing? What are we looking for that might make us understand that someone is in denial?
Well, one of the things that I found, like when we've talked about this before, which I hadn't really known, you know, until we began talking about this, is that procrastination can be an indicator of this. It's, you know, you can always find something else to do instead of dealing with the thing that might remind you, I guess it is, or
yeah. So procrastination, it can appear in both, but actually it's in confusion in that you might be swinging between the two, but actually what I'm looking for is when you're in denial, you'll be saying certain things and you'll be doing certain things. One of them might be procrastinating, yes, and that could also come into confusion. But what are you saying? Think about when something's happened to you that you haven't wanted to change. What do you say to people? You're not going, yay, great, change is coming, because that's not true. You're doing something very different.
I suppose you're blaming everyone else, aren't you? You're looking for somebody to blame. It won't happen. It's not going to work. This is the crazy thing to do. You're just going to be completely negative about everything.
You are. It's exactly that. You're really negative. So procrastination might come in here, but actually people are quite vocal often here, especially if it's really worrying them. And you'll get teams coming together going, well, this can't happen. This is ridiculous. Why is he or she making us do this? Why is everything changing? We didn't need this to change. That is denial talking. Now, what we can do when people are in denial is what they need to understand is what's in it for them. How can we calm down this flight or fight feeling and you know, just calm the waters a bit, because they're literally on fire going, this is terrifying. Even though they don't know it unconsciously, it's terrifying. So we need to provide them with enough joy of what's going to happen at the end of it so that they can start to feel the reward attached to it, not just the threat, because currently they're in threat state. So we look at what's in it for them personally, what's in it for them as an organization, and really help them understand it. This is so often missed when big change initiatives are coming, is we forget to tell people or help them see the joy, the possibilities, the positivity. And even sometimes if there isn't any, it just has to happen. We don't even share that. We just hide. So if you are leading others, please take time to help them understand how it's going to help them personally and organizationally, so they can feel some attachment to the positive side of it. If we don't catch people here, they go into what's called the dungeon of denial. And this is where we've all been in places like this, where you've got people around the water cooler or they're WhatsApping each other going, this is rubbish, this is rubbish. And once you're in the dungeon of denial, it's really hard to get people out. These people become cancerous to organizations. They drag everyone down. Even if someone was about to go, oh, this is a good idea, they'll go, no, it's not. And they'll drag them down with them. So we need to manage this denial piece really quickly and effectively. And if people go into the dungeon, you've got a much bigger problem. It's very hard to get them out of there. Okay, makes sense so far?
Yeah, I love this. As always, busy, busy scribbling. Yeah, carry on.
I'm just seeing if there are any questions that have come in. I don't think so yet, so we're okay.
Not relevant. There have been a couple of comments, but they weren't relevant to the topic. So
say I've caught you as your leader or I'm the leader of myself, and I've noticed that I'm going, oh, I can't do that. This won't work. Oh, I'll go and tidy the loft. I won't go back to that one, but someone who might be watching will know what I mean when I say that. Procrastination might come in. You say I catch you and I help you understand the positives and the reason why, and you really get it. You might not like it, but you really get it. You then go into the stage of confusion, which is, I get it. How do I do it? Now, this is the next thing that's often missed is, all right, you've got it. Right, go and do it. Hold on. How? Who's going to help me? Where do I go for support? What do I need to learn? What are the new systems, processes, everything? Because there will be probably something new that you need to do. It might be a skill or a tool, but there's something new you're going to need to dial up and use or learn to be able to do this, because it's different. If you are in confusion, how does that look then? How is it different to denial? What are we looking for then? Because it's a different language you'll hear. You'll see different behaviors.
Well, this is where This is where it would be handy to be able to ask for help, but people don't like asking for help, do they? Mm-hmm. So then I can see it says paralysis, and that's that. I don't know what to do. I don't want to ask for help. I know I need to ask for help. I don't know who to ask for help. Where's the direction? I guess we really need hand-holding at this bit, don't we?
Well, you need a real clear vision. The vision will have come out into the denial, but you're in denial a bit, but you'll also need, this is now where your goals come in. And then within your goals, how am I going to support you, or how am I going to support myself? So I'm thinking about when I've pivoted in my business and gone, I'm now going to work with these people. Right. What do I need to learn? What do I need to do? Who can help me do that? You've got to be able to lead yourself through this, because not all leaders are going to go, right, let me hold your hand and show you. Mm. You might need to ask them. So here it is, tell me how. It's not, I don't think we should. It's tell me how, I don't understand. But it can sound very similar to denial. And what I notice in leaders is they get very cross with people in confusion, going, why are they blocking me? Why are they blocking this? They're just confused. They just don't know how. Or it was your fault because you didn't explain it to them properly in the first place. So this takes away these people that are problem children in our organizations. No. I don't think they've been looked after well enough. This is what I often see. And then when I go in and speak to them, they're like, well, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know why we're doing it. And after that conversation, they're like, I get it. I feel safe now. This has got a lot to do with psychological safety.
Yeah. Yeah, this is something where there are like two comments here that are kind of relevant rather. Joanna was saying, you say yes, but, and that was more kind of the in the denial view. But it can also come in on this confusion stage where it's like, this is what we need to do now. This is the new thing. And when people are saying yes, but, often that is either yes, but I'm concerned, but also yes, but I don't know how. And how
do you know the difference between the two?
Yeah, that's what I think is quite relevant.
Yeah, absolutely. So if I hear someone say yes, but, my question often is, do you understand why we're doing this or the need for this? And if they say yeah, and I go, well, explain it to me. If they can, it's probably not denial. Because they'll have got it, and you'll say, well, how convinced are you? How inspired by it? Well, I am, but I just don't know how. Then you'll see. So by the questions that you ask, it's about digging a little bit deeper rather than just accepting someone is just being irritating and blocking you, and knowing that there are certain behaviours to look out for.
Yeah.
But just before I finish on the confusion bit, I can see, I think Chris is
added. Yeah, I was just going to.
Rumours. Okay, rumours, whispers and discontent must be nipped in the bud. Yeah, otherwise they have a nasty habit of festering, growing out of control. Absolutely. That's where the dungeon of denial comes in. And I've seen that so many times. It's really hard to be the one person that goes, I'm actually quite excited about this. You just can't. So you think, because we like to be part of the in crowd. So this is back to the scarf model that I've talked about in the past and being part of the team. So it's really difficult to stand out.
And that's where you kind of you get in danger of losing people.
Well, that's what I was going to say also is that if you've got the first couple of people who go into the confusion room and say, wait a minute, yes, but I don't know how to do that and whatnot, you have to firstly, as management, look to recognize that those people are actually asking for help, not saying they don't want to do it. They might just not be starting the sentence clearly. But also those people are at a very fragile transition point and they could be dragged into the dungeon quite easily by others if they don't get that information and help that they need, can't they?
Completely. I've got a really, really quite sad example of this. Someone that I'm working with at the moment, she went in to ask for help because she's in a transition phase and she was told to just go away and toughen up and stop being so needy. I won't say who and I won't say which organisation, but my face was like, okay, we can see why there's a problem in that organisation. That is not the way to handle someone who needs your support. So Chris is saying communicating the need for change, absolutely. Yep. The need, the impact on the individuals, the benefits, what's in it for me, yeah, get the whiff from in there and define what success looks like. gaining buy-in is key. Yes. But they're going to do that once you know where you want to go. That's a really good point, is if you are helping someone through change and you aren't bought into it, what do you do then? Well, first of all, you have to manage yourself. So you have to take yourself through this and go, right, what do I need? Because it's very difficult to be authentic and helping others if you're not feeling it too. Sometimes as leaders, we just have to suck it up and just do it and say, look, I'm not 100% into this, but we're going to give it a go. What's the worst that can happen? We're going to try this. Sometimes being more honest about it, but being positively forward focused is the right thing to do. So if I don't catch you in confusion and I don't solve your problems and I tell you to go away and toughen up, for example, people go into what's called the paralysis pit, where they literally are paralyzed. They can't move. They do nothing. Productivity at this point is at zero. And people either go into paralysis and stay in paralysis, which is really costly to an organization. But what you find is really good, dynamic, self-confident people will leave.
Yeah.
The people that were making you a load of money, who you've invested in, who are your true assets, will leave the building through the wrong exit door, but the right exit for them because they weren't looked after. And the amount of people leaving organizations because they're in denial or in confusion and they haven't been looked after properly is crazy, when it can be so easily solved if you understand this. So if we spend some time helping you understand the what, the why, the how, the what if, the benefits, the downsides, we're really honest about it, and we put a plan together and we go for it, you can catch people very quickly and get them into what's called the room of renewal, which is where your energy levels are up. You wake up in the morning thinking, right, I've got a plan. I know what I'm doing. I know how to do it. I might be a bit scared, but I'm excited because I know what's in it for me. I know what's in it for the organization. And hopefully we're in it together. Now, for us entrepreneurs or solopreneurs, we have to be in it together on our own. So you really, as someone who works on their own, if you don't get this, it can hold you right back. And you can go into that procrastination, this area of, oh, well, I'll just wait. I'll just do this first. I'll just do that first. No, you're just in denial or confusion. Yeah. So notice your procrastination and what it's doing for you. It's keeping you safe from harm, safety from change.
Yeah, we've got a really good reminder from Deborah as well, for building in some quick wins that show the start of the benefits and can be woven into the story of change in the communication.
Brilliant.
Absolutely.
That's really true, isn't it? That's such a motivator, because if the change is big and it's not going to come for a while and you're not going to see the big benefits, it is absolutely important to put some of those quick wins in there to keep people motivated on the journey that, yes, we are going the right way. Yes, we're on that. We're on our way. You're going the right direction.
Massively important. And thanks, Deborah, for bringing that up, because part of all the work that I do, irrespective of the program that you're working on with me, we always look at what the vision of the future is. And I was talking to two people this morning, and their vision, the big, hairy, scary goal, was going to happen in 2 years' time. Now, we can't just wait for 2 years to happen. So that's the big domino at the end. It's all these tiny little milestone dominoes, that's not easy to say, that you're tipping over all the time. And if you don't have a leader, you need to do this for yourself. What am I looking for? How will I know I've been successful? You've got to keep feeling the joy. So whether you do it once a day or once a week and look back and think, what did I do well? And give yourself some rewards, tiny little things. Maybe your reward is going to the gym. Maybe it's having a bar of chocolate. Maybe it's a glass of wine. Maybe it's speaking to a friend you haven't spoken to. Maybe it's buying something new for your wardrobe. It doesn't matter, but have lots of little rewards and milestones that you can tick off, because your leaders ain't going to do that for you as well as you can. And I believe if we all become a bit more DIY, even if we have a leader and we do it ourselves, whatever we get from our leaders or from other people is a cherry on top. So I'm all about building resilience and mental toughness and confidence. And you do that by leading yourself better first.
So Sarah, if for people who are like, in a position where they suddenly have to take on, you know, or help a team, and they've got a history of not having, you know, awareness of this house, right? And so you're coming in and people may already be in the dungeon of despair dungeon of denial.
And well, it's despair and denial, and, to be fair.
and also there might be some people who are already in that paralysis state, you know, because maybe they were interested in promoting the change, but then didn't get the support they needed in a timely fashion, and have fallen into that paralysis state. When people get into that red zone that you're showing there, you know, are there any quick ways to kind of assess where those people are, and for, you know, when you're new to the project, and strategies for kind of trying to quickly lift people out of those red zones and back into a zone where they can proceed through the cycle?
Really good question. So is all lost when we're in the red zone? No. Are some people lost in the red zone? Yes. What can you do about it? The first thing to do is to not ignore it. And I have seen leader after leader coming in going, I'll just pretend that's not happening. And that's the worst thing you can do. So team meetings, getting together, this is what's going on. How are you feeling? I go into organizations and I run this as a session. And so people can talk about openly, where are they? Where are they? Where do they feel they are right now? What help do they need? And then they've got a language and a common language to be able to say, I'm feeling a bit dungeony today. Can someone help? Or I'm a bit stuck in confusion. And also we've talked about this in the past, and with the communication skills side of things as well, something that brings the team together and allows them to voice their opinions. However, you have to be very clear, we are not staying stuck in the past. We will not accept behavior that allows us to stay there. If you want to be on this journey, if you want to go somewhere, you know, here's our vision of the future, make sure you've got one. Here's our vision. If you want to get on this bus and come with me, we need to step it up. But how can I help you? But you ain't staying there. All right, that's not happening. And what often happens is the poor behavior is ignored. And eventually you're ending up in a position where you have to get rid of the person, or the leader goes because they can't take it anymore. So set your boundaries, agree your behaviors, agree the values, agree the vision, because that's what's going to take you to the vision, and then manage this process by talking about it and flushing it all out really quickly. Loads of empathy as well. I get it. I understand. It doesn't mean I agree. But I get it, I understand, really important.
I think, you know, showing the house is a good way, because people don't recognize where they are, and they might not have recognized that they're in denial, but they, you know, they don't want to feel like that. You don't want to be unhappy, but you vent it, you know, when you are confused and you know, when you are uncomfortable. So I think, as you say, giving them a language and words that they can grab hold of and talk about openly, because it's not just them. It's not them who are at fault. This is what we're going through, because this is what happens when we go through change. It allows them then to see that there is a path out of it as well. So I think showing this and getting people to talk about it openly is a really good idea.
It is. And when you've got someone that you trust, if you trust the leader, brilliant, or you trust an external coach or a mentor to come in and do this and do it as a group session, whatever you do, it's remembering that this is a normal process we all go through. And when we recognize where we are, we can choose to do something about it. What we're not doing when we don't understand this is we are not making active, conscious choices to move ourselves through it, because we don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
We just know we're stuck. Mm-hmm. Chris, there needs to be objectives and key results for progress. Absolutely. So I haven't gone into SMART objectives, but I don't do SMART, I do SMARTE, because SMART's a bit boring. I like to have inspirational and exciting or emotionally attached ones as well. But yeah, it all, so much comes out of this. Goal setting, everything.
We're very big into OKRs at 2i. That's our thing. Objectives. OKRs. Yeah, the objectives and key results. So what is the objective? what are the key results that we're looking for that tells us that we've reached that objective? What does it look like? So that's our kind of language.
And do you have all the key behaviours and values that allow that to happen? Because mm-hmm. that's often missing. And when you talk about values and behaviours, it all starts to come together, because you've got to have, if someone isn't behaving in a positive way, even if they're stuck, it slows everything down. Mm-hmm. I think that was all I was going to cover, other than to say change requires a lot of energy. We go into a threat state. You've got to remember to look for the joy somewhere. Think of the rewards. That's really important. Otherwise, you're going to stay in a threat state. You might procrastinate. You might just decide it's not worth it. You might be making decisions based on mistruths you're telling yourself. So self-leadership, self-management, understanding what's going on in there, so important for this.
That's great. I did just that point, because we're talking about objectives. So we're going through quite a lot of change at 2i. We've got a new management team that are working together, and we've got quarterly kind of change initiatives where cross-functionally we're working to bringing teams together to kind of achieve milestones to get us to where we want to be. And we talk a lot about OKRs, so objectives and key results. And in our last session, we talked more about behavior and things like that and values. That's all good. But I think that last point you made there, what's the joy? What is that ultimate payoff? We'll achieve the objectives, but as a team or as individuals, what's the joy? And I think that's I'm going to Glasgow this afternoon, so we've got another meeting tomorrow. Yeah. So I'm gonna put that forward.
Well, actually, now you've raised that, one of the when you're working in a matrix, where everybody's working in a matrix, aren't they? Really, is that everybody's responsible. So if the marketing function doesn't do what it needs to do, the sales function can't do operation. Da da da.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
all
yeah.
work together. Irrespective of the level you're at, when you understand what people are trying to achieve personally, their personal drivers. If you are missing asking those questions, what's in it for you? What are you trying to achieve personally? You're missing a big, big trick, because you can use that in these conversations and all growth conversations. And wherever there's a problem, remember what we're trying to achieve as an organization, but for you as a human. And as soon as we connect the head and the heart, people are far more on board.
And it's startling how the different people in the team are very motivated by entirely different things.
Completely.
Yeah, and you kind of, you hear someone say what they're motivated by, and I'm kind of like, oh, really? Because that's polar opposite to me. And it's really important to understand, as you say, those individual objectives, to understand where everyone's coming from, and so that we all know what's
this is why standard reward and recognition is a really short-term motivator. It's just the bog standard. But until I know that you like Space NK, and a £5 Space NK voucher might be the thing that just drives you wild, I'm never going to get the best out of you.
Yeah.
I know you want more than 10K, 5K at Space NK, but you know. Danny says, how can people show poor behavior if we haven't been clear on culture expectations or values and our purpose? It becomes much more subjective. Exactly. And shows the importance of setting the cultural foundations of your team, group, or organization. Absolutely. Wherever I go in and it's going wrong, it's because that hasn't happened. We have to go back to basics. What are you trying to achieve? What are the behaviors? What are the values? How do you want to work as an organization? When you've got that right, everything else sits on top of that. Absolutely spot on.
Yep. And one more from Chris as well.
Yeah. Bite-sized chunks are better. Look at the big end game, but then break it down into milestones. No one can work on a big, huge, hairy goal if all they're seeing is the big, huge, hairy goal. They've got to see how it all connects together.
Yeah.
Marvellous.
Fabulous. Well, we're on time. That's it. Well done. Well, thank you very much. Shall we switch you back to our normal?
Yeah, make me small again.
Thank make you small again. Brilliant and very colourful. You look very summery today, may I say.
Thank you. The sun's now shining again, so it's the right thing to be wearing. It wasn't
absolutely. And you're all stripy with the zebra, and it's all
cool. Yeah. I was going to say it all blends.
The red and the blue and the white on the board match the top. Yes. It's so coordinated.
Yeah.
And because it was so rainy, I'm wearing black. So next week, I think it's me, isn't it? What am I going to talk about? Well, I'll be camping this weekend, so we might be doing bushcraft. I don't know. But I was thinking, really,
from ball gals to bushcraft.
Ball gowns to bushcraft. There you go. What more do you? But I think we've talked about visibility, because obviously my topic is marketing. We've talked about visibility.
Can I stop you a second? I know exactly what you're doing next week.
What are we doing?
Ashley Leeds is coming in next week.
Yeah,
you're the week after, my love.
All right, so then it won't be bushcraft. I can say
no, it won't be. You saved everyone. No, Ashley's coming in, and he's going to be talking about LinkedIn for leaders. So how can you make the most out of LinkedIn? He's amazing. He knows his stuff. Please check him out. And he's going to be on the show next week. And I'm going to be on holiday. So he's going to be me.
Brilliant. No, Ashley's great. And he's very enthusiastic and energetic. It will be loads of fun. So that'll be great to have. I didn't realize it was last week. How silly. Fabulous. Great. Then that's it. We'll see you next week then. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks for your comments. Yeah. Take care. Have a good week.
Take care. Have a good... Bye.
Bye.